I'm Nick Pettit.
And I'm Jason Seifer.
And you're watching the Treehouse Show, your weekly dose of internets where we talk about all things web design, web development, and more.
In this episode, we'll be talking about Twitter Bootstrap, Relogo, and our app review is Alfred.
Let's get into it. First up is Twitter Bootstrap, which is now in version 2.2.0.
Oh, wow.
Ooh. If you go over to the Get Bootstrap blog, you can check out the release notes. I really like this trend of including a TLDR. They say that there are 4 new example templates. They added media component, new typographic scale, fixed that box shadow mix-in bug thingy, and they fixed some Z index issues. So let's just go ahead and look at the first couple highlights here. So they added 4 new templates to the docs, including a narrow marketing page, a sign-in form, a sticky footer, and a fancy carousel, which is great because I hate those unfancy carousels. And basically, you know, that's just really nice if you're trying to create some of those things, such as, you know, a sticky footer. And because when you're trying to make some of those things, it's sometimes a little tricky to figure out exactly how to do them. So it's nice that they have an example of how to do them in Twitter Bootstrap. The other thing that I really like as a designer is that they have this new variable-driven typographic scale based on base font size and base line height.
As a developer, I have no clue how those things relate to each other.
Well, basically, if you're coding along in your styling, you can go ahead and set something based on the base font size or the base line height, which means the, you know, the first time you set it or something like that. I know what I'm talking about.
So instead of using Twitter's defaults, you can change them to your own and have that work in your own documents?
Exactly.
Very nice. One thing that I kind of like about it, you remember how we talked about Bower a couple episodes ago?
I do.
If you don't remember that, check out our YouTube channel at youtube.com/gotreehouse. Bower is a package management system for your website, and they've included support for Twitter Bootstrap into Bower, so that's cool.
Very cool stuff.
Also of note is that jQuery and plugins were updated to 1.8.1. So next up, keeping along the whole Bootstrap theme, is something called Bootbox.js. I know, it's very close to Beatbox, but we're not going to beatbox on this show.
Thank goodness.
Yeah, our superiors denied that request. So this takes the whole idea of Bootstrap's modals and alerts and lets you do alert, confirm, and have dialogues on them. So what does that mean? Well, if you click run the example here on the site, this is just kind of a default alert box. And you see it says hello world, but it has an OK button. In regular Twitter Bootstrap, you can click out of there and the modal window will dismiss. So you actually have the option to specify that, no, you can't just dismiss this. You have to hit OK. So there's the same thing for confirms and prompting things. And there is also a ton of different options that you have on the site. You can put dynamic content in there that they have an example changes with jQuery. And just a ton of different stuff. And this is bootbox.js.
That's a really nice addition to Twitter Bootstrap because, you know, while those modal windows are sometimes annoying, they're also sometimes very necessary. And when you do want to display them, a lot of times you don't want people to be able to just click out of them and dismiss them. It really is a point where
it's my website, not yours.
That's right. And you have to show them who's boss.
Exactly.
Well, it's really a point where the user has to make a decision about one thing or another before they can continue using the app. So it's nice that they allow that functionality.
Definitely.
Pretty cool.
It's very dashing.
It is. Next up is dashing. And if you go to their website, you can see that it's an exceptionally handsome dashboard framework, and you can tell that because there's a little bow tie right here on the website.
That is dashing.
That is. Basically, it's a dashboard framework, just like it says. You can go ahead and plug in your data sources and put together a drag and drop interface of, you know, a bunch of different dashboard widgets.
Wow.
And it's just really easy to put together. And, you know, I think bosses everywhere are going to love this because it's got widgets, it's got dashboards, it's got
everything.
It's got APIs and it's got drag and drop. I mean, it's really got all the buzzwords going for it. And uh, that's uh, you know, that's really a win-win-win.
From what I understand, it's also pretty easy to pipe your own information in there.
Exactly. So you can just, like I said, plug in those data sources and go ahead and put together dashboards really quickly.
I feel like a bow tie is a mustache for your suit.
That's an interesting point of view, Jason.
Let that one marinate while we go to the app of the week.
I'm going to think about that.
Our app review this week is an app called Alfred, which you can get at alfredapp.com. Now, Alfred is an application that is completely ingrained to my way of life, not even just how I work on the computer. You can tell it's awesome based solely on the icon, which is a top hat with a magnifying glass. So what does Alfred do? It lets you assign a shortcut to Alfred, which brings up a really small search box in the middle of your screen. So if we can cut to my computer here, we'll show you what that is. So let's say you want to launch Safari. You can press the Alfred shortcut, which in my case is Command Space, and then just start typing in the name of the application you want to launch. So Safari, press that, and then you could press Enter, and that would launch Safari. Now, in addition to just launching applications, it also gives you access to contacts, as well as files and things like that. The really nice part about Alfred is that you can have it do things for you based on these actions. So if you find a file, you can press another button and then with just one command, launch that, email that, anything. There's kind of a lot of stuff that goes on in Alfred. I recommend that you download the trial and give it a chance. Really read the documentation and see what's going on there. Completely invaluable.
So it's like a more advanced version of the Spotlight functionality in Mac OS X.
Yeah, it's like Spotlight on steroids.
It sounds like you're more reliant on Alfred than Batman. All
Touché.
Right, moving on. Next up is Relogo. And this is basically a new type of relative link that you can put in the top of your website in the head section. So you drop in Relogo, and you drop in an SVG version of your logo, and then people can go ahead and find the SVG version of your logo rather than, say, going to Google Image Search, typing in logo for such and such thing or company, and then taking the, you know, terrible GIF version that's in like the footer or something like that. I find that that's very common when people are putting together marketing materials. They'll just Google for the logo and they'll get the terrible version of it rather than going to, say, the press or media page and getting the high quality version of that image. So this is a great way to just kind of consolidate all that and provide people with the latest and greatest high quality version of your logo, and it's in vector format, so it'll be, you know, good for any size of media.
Now, I think it's worth noting this is a proposed standard. Some very smart designers said, hey, this is happening a lot. Maybe we should make this a standard.
So you could start including it in your website. It's not really going to do anything yet, but by including it, you're basically casting your vote saying, yes, I think this is a good idea. And yes, there should be some sort of mechanism to go ahead and support this. So say, for example, Google might go ahead and start supporting the standard in their Google image search, and you can go ahead and say, like, I'm searching for logos, and it will go ahead and bring up all of these. So there's other ways that this could be supported, but if you start including it now, you know, and everybody starts doing it, it can be a thing that is useful to everybody.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Yep.
Next up, we have something called JQ. This is, as it says on the website, a lightweight and flexible command line JSON parser. Now, we've talked about command line JSON parsers and processors on the show before. This goes that extra mile, where instead of just getting JSON from an external website, this actually lets you process and parse it and output it into a different format. So this is going to be really, really useful where you're trying to massage different data streams and maybe change something around. Say you get a JSON list of users and your application calls them people. You would use something like JQ to redo that format. Really interesting, really technical application. It's written in C and it's kind of cross-platform. You should be able to upload it to any server very easily and have it just work. We'll have a link to that in the show notes, but you can get it at stedolon.github.com/JQ.
Very cool stuff. Next up is Gridlover, and if you love grids, then you're going to love this, because it's called Gridlover. All right.
I have a bumper sticker that says, I heart grids.
That's a complete lie.
The heart means love.
Gridlover is the tool to establish a type system with modular scale and vertical rhythm to build upon. Go ahead and launch Gridlover right here. Let's do it. So when you click on this, you can get these little sliders up at the top of the page, and you can go ahead and adjust things like the body font size, the line height, or the scale factor of the fonts, and then you can go ahead and grab the CSS for this, and that's pretty handy if you're just trying to quickly visually experiment with different typographic settings, because sometimes when you're just doing this all in CSS, or you're doing this with like a CSS framework, it can be difficult to quickly experiment with this because you're constantly changing values in your text editor, then going back to the browser and hitting refresh and wondering if that was a good change or not. This way, with this tool, you can go ahead and just use these sliders in sort of a WYSIWYG interface, if you will, and see the results immediately. So I think it's really, you know, a pretty cool tool for designers to go ahead and do type settings.
I don't know if you should limit that to just designers or everybody that loves grids.
I think everyone loves grids, so it's probably for everybody.
Next up, we have a framework called Bonsai. This is a JavaScript library and graphics API with an SVG renderer that lets you make cool shapes and animate them, or not animate them if you don't want to. Yeah.
That's amazing.
So they have some really fun examples on the screen right there. You see that? Look at all these circles. You want circles on your website flying out at you?
Boom, you got them.
Yeah, use Bonsai.js. You want to play Pong on your website? Boom, use Bonsai.js. Pretty easy and pretty intuitive graphics library to use. So that's about all I have to say for Bonsai. It's a pretty interesting graphics library.
With Retina displays taking over the world, it's really great to see the development of SVG tools like this, because I think more and more people are going to want to include vector graphics in their website to, you know, respond to all sorts of different displays, regardless of, you know, how many pixels they have.
Right.
So I'm glad to see that there's tools like this coming out. It's really cool.
Oh, definitely.
That's it for this week. If you want to follow us on Twitter, I'm at NickRP.
And I am at JSeifer. If you want more information on anything that we talked about, you can check out the show notes on our YouTube channel at youtube.com/gotreehouse.
And of course, if you'd like to see more videos like this one about web design, web development, business, iOS, or Android, you can check us out at teamtreehouse.com. That's it for this week. See you soon. I'm going to go to the next one.